Assalamu alaikum. I'm Professor Dr. Hayder Mubarak. This is a presentation to osteology of the skull or anatomy of the skull. Usually the skull is studied when you look to it from different direction. For example, if you look to it from above, the superior view is called norma verticalis. If you look to the skull from anterior aspect, the front, you will say this is norma frontalis. If you look to the skull from lateral side, it will be norma lateralis. Therefore, we will start with the superior view of the skull, which is norma verticalis. Bones forming the norma verticalis are the frontal bone, right and left parietal bone, and occipital bone. These bones are also seen in this figure, the frontal bone, the right and left parietal bone, and posteriorly is the occipital bone. Features of the norma verticalis: anteriorly, the frontal bone shows prominences, which are called the frontal prominences. You have a joint or a suture between the frontal bone anteriorly and the right and left parietal bone. This suture is called coronal suture. Also, there is a suture or joint between the right and left parietal bone, which is called sagittal suture. And posteriorly, there is a joint between the parietal bones and the occipital bone, which is this one, called lambdoid suture. You have a point of meeting between the sagittal suture and coronal suture. This point of meeting is called the prigma. And the point of meeting between the sagittal suture and the lambdoid suture is called the lambda. The prigma and lambda in neonate are formed by a membrane, which is called fontanelle. So the prigma is a site of anterior fontanelle in neonate, and the lambda is a site of posterior fontanelle and neonate, which are membranes. These fontanelles will ossify later on in life. The anterior fontanelle at the prigma will ossify in about 1.5 years of age, and the posterior fontanelle at the lambda will be closed or ossified at about 6 months. Also, on the sides of the posterior part of the sagittal suture are two foramina that are called parietal foramina, or foramina in the parietal bone. These foramina serves for entry of emissary veins from the scalp to the inside of the scalp. So they are called parietal foramina for emissary veins. The view of the skull from above, which is the norma verticalis, could be considered as the cup of the brain, which is called brain cup. Also, sometimes it is called calvaria or cranial vault. If you open this, if you detach this, these bones forming the brain cup and look to it from inside, this is an inside view to the brain cup or the calvaria or called the cranial valve. First, you will see that the cut edge of the bone shows an inner compact layer and outer compact layer, and in between them is a spongy bone. This in between spongy bone is called the diplo of the skull. Anteriorly in the frontal bone, the calvaria will show the cavity in the frontal bone, which is a cavity of the frontal air sinus, which is one of the paranasal air sinuses. And also the inside of the cranial vault will show a frontal crest in the midline of the frontal bone. The sagittal suture from inside shows a groove, a sagittal groove, which is a groove for one of the venous sinuses inside the skull, which is called superior sagittal sinus. This superior sagittal sinus lying in this groove on the inside of the sagittal suture is one of the venous sinuses inside the skull formed by the dura, one of the dural layer of the meninges. On the side of the groove of the superior sagittal sinus, there are many fovea or pits, as you can see. These are fovea for arachnoid granulation, in which the arachnoid matter of the meninges form tuft of tissue here, and these pits or fovea for arachnoid granulation. These tuft of arachnoid granulation and these pits or fovea serve for absorbance of the cerebrospinal fluid. Also, the inside of the calvaria or the brain cup or the cranial valve shows marking of the artery inside the skull, which is middle meningeal artery. This artery produces marking on the skull. This is all about the norma verticalis. Now we will describe looking to the looking of the skull from the front. Here we have to say that the skull without mandible is called the cranium. And the skull is a term referred to the cranium plus the mandible. Of course, the skull with the mandible is about is formed of 22 bones. So the cranium is formed of 21 bones. Bones forming the front, the norma frontalis are the frontal bone, which is a single bone, the right and left zygomatic bone, the right and left maxilla bone, the right and left nasal bones, and the mandible. In order to study features of the norma frontalis, we will divide it into forehead region, the regions of the orbital opening, the region of the nasal opening, and the lower face. The forehead region shows the prominences of the frontal bone, the frontal prominences, and it shows an arch above the medial half of the supraorbital margin. This is the superior orbital margin. Above the medial half of the superior orbital margin is an arch, which is called superciliary arch. It lies below the eyebrows. The superciliary arch is a prominent bony arch above the medial half of the supraorbital margin. The right and left superciliary arches meet in the midline in an elevated area, which is called the glabella. That is very important in a clinical examination. The anterior opening of the orbit, or the orbital aperture, is formed, it is a quadrilateral, of course. It's formed of four borders, or it has four borders. The upper border is formed by the frontal bone. The lateral border is formed by the frontal bone and zygomatic bone. And actually, this piece is called zygomatic process of a frontal bone, and this piece is called the frontal process of zygomatic bone, both these forming the lateral border of the orbit, of the orbital opening. The inferior border of the orbital opening is formed by the zygomatic bone and by maxilla, while the medial border is formed by the frontal bone and maxilla. And actually, again, this part is called maxillary process of a frontal, while this bone is called frontal process of maxilla, both forming the medial margin of the anterior orbital foramen. You can see that there is a notch in the superior orbital margin at the junction of the medial one-third of this margin and the lateral two-third. This notch, which may be sometime a foramen, is called supraorbital notch or foramen, also seen here. This supraorbital notch or foramen transmits or allows passage of a nerve and vessels of the same name. The anterior nasal aperture is formed above by the nasal bone and inferiorly and on the sides by the nasal notch of maxilla bone. You can see that the nasal bones articulate posteriorly with the frontal process of maxilla, while in the midline, the right and left nasal bone articulate with each other by an internasal suture. The point of meeting of the internasal suture with the frontonasal suture is called the nasion. You can see that the nasal notch of maxilla meet in the midline and inferiorly in a spine, which is called anterior nasal spine. Also, you can see that the maxilla below the inferior orbital margin is showing a foramen, which is called infraorbital foramen, that is in the same vertical line of the supraorbital notch or foramen. This infraorbital foramen in the maxilla transmit nerve and vessels of the same name, infraorbital nerve and infraorbital vessel. The maxilla forms the prominence of the cheek. Regarding the lower face shows the alveoli of maxilla that are carrying the teeth. And these alveoli form the maxilla, the alveolar process of maxilla. And also the mandible shows alveoli or alveolar process for the teeth. Above the canine tooth, you know, we have four incisors, one canine, two premolar, and two molar. Above the canine tooth is a prominent bone, which is called canine prominence. Medial to this canine prominence is a fossa called incisive fossa because it is above the incisor teeth, while lateral to this canine prominence is a canine fossa. So the canine prominence is above the canine tooth, medial to it is an incisive fossa in the maxilla above the incisive tooth, and lateral to it is the canine fossa The mandible anteriorly, chiffoned by the body of the mandible, and there is bilateral upward projecting rami of the mandible. You can see that the most anterior part or in the midline of the body of mandible shows a triangular bone which is called mental protuberance. The lateral angles of the mental protuberance is called mental tubercle, while the apex of the mental protuberance is called symphysis menti. The tubercle, which is the lateral end of the triangular mental protuberance, continues with an oblique line that extends to the anterior border of the ramus of the mandible. And at about the middle of this oblique line is a foramen. Above this, the middle of this oblique line is a foramen, which is called mental foramen, that lies between the first and second premolar teeth. The ramus of the mandible is formed by coronoid process and condyloid process, and in between them is the mandibular notch. This is another figure showing the demonstration of structures that we had just described. Now we have to describe the lateral view of the skull, which is the norma lateralis. Looking to the skull from the lateral side, this is the norma lateralis. Bones forming the norma lateralis are parietal bone, frontal bone, zygomatic bone, temporal bone, greater wing of a sphenoid, and in addition to zygomatic bone, the mandible also, and also maxilla. The features of the norma lateralis are the following. Most markedly, you can see that the norma lateralis shows a fossa here, which is called temporal fossa. This temporal fossa is bounded by the temporal lines. You can see that the temporal lines begins here on the frontal bone as a continuation of the posterior border of the frontal process of the zygomatic process of frontal bone. This is the zygomatic process of frontal bone, and this is the frontal process of zygomatic bone. From the posterior border of the zygomatic process of a frontal bone, the temporal line begins and ascends upward and backward on the frontal bone. And after crossing the coronal suture, the temporal line divides into two lines, superior temporal line and inferior temporal lines. And these two lines continues backward and then downward. The superior temporal line disappears, fade out, while the inferior temporal line continues with the crest, which is called supramastoid crest, because it is above the mastoid process. This is the supramastoid crest. Next, the supramastoid crest continues with the upper border of the zygomatic arch. And then we will the line continues with the posterior border of the frontal process of zygomatic bone. These descriptions that I had just made are the boundaries of the temporal fossa. So I will repeat them. Anteriorly, the temporal fossa is bounded by the posterior process of frontal process of zygomatic bone and the posterior border of the zygomatic process of frontal bone. The upper border of the temporal fossa formed by the temporal line that extends backward and upward crossing the coronal suture, then it divides into superior and inferior temporal lines. Then the superior and inferior temporal lines continues backward and then downward. The superior temporal line fade out while the inferior temporal line continues as a boundary of the temporal fossa, and it turns forward, continue with the supramastoid crest, or called supramietal crest, and then the line continues with the upper border of the zygomatic arch. You can see that this temporal fossa is formed by the frontal bone, parietal bone, temporal bone, and the greater wing of the sphenoid. This piece of temporal bone is called squamous temporal bone. These four bones meet in an H-shaped suture, which is called terion. This terion is the site also of a membrane in neonate, which is called anterolateral fontanelle, that ossifies at about 3 to 6 months of age. So this is one of the features of the norma lateralis. Also, the normal lateralis here shows an arch which is called zygomatic arch. It is formed by the temporal process of zygomatic bone and zygomatic process of temporal bone. This zygomatic process of temporal bone forms about the posterior two-thirds of the arch, of the zygomatic arch, where the anterior one-third of the zygomatic arch is only formed by the temporal process of zygomatic bone. The zygomatic process of temporal bone forming the arch is sometimes called zygoma. And deep to it is a space that connects the temporal fossa with the cavity below that is called infratemporal fossa. This cavity of infratemporal fossa is behind or deep to the ramus of the mandible. So the cavity deep to the zygomatic arch connects the temporal fossa that we had just described with an fossa below here is called infratemporal fossa that is deep to the ramus of the mandible. The normal lateralis also shows this process, which is called mastoid process, which is part of the mastoid temporal bone. Here we are seeing two parts of temporal bone. This piece is called squamous temporal bone, while this piece is called the mastoid temporal bone, which shows a prominent that called mastoid process. The mastoid process lies posterior and inferior to the opening of the ear, which is the external auditory meatus. You can see that the external auditory meatus is formed anteriorly, inferiorly, and half of the posterior aspect of it is formed by a tympanic plate of temporal bone. So we are now seeing three pieces of temporal bone: squamous temporal, mastoid temporal, and tympanic plate of temporal bone. Therefore, the external auditory meatus is bounded above by the squamous temporal and bounded anteriorly, inferiorly by the tympanic plate of temporal. Posteriorly, it is bounded by both squamous temporal above and tympanic temporal below. Anterior to the mastoid process, this is the mastoid process of temporal mastoid temporal bone. Anterior to it and medial to it, anteromedial to it, is a small bony projection from the base of the skull, which is called the styloid process, which is also a piece of temporal bone. Therefore, we had now seen four parts of temporal bone: squamous temporal, mastoid temporal, tympanic plate, and the styloid process. The lateral aspect of the skull, the normal lateralis, also shows the ramus of the mandible. The anterior part of the mandible is called body, and the lateral parts projecting upward is called the ramus of the mandible. The ramus has appeared as a quadrilateral bone. It has an upper two projections. The anterior one is called coronoid process, and the posterior one is called condyloid process, and in between them is a notch, which is called mandibular notch. You can see that the condyloid process formed the temporomandibular joint with the temporal bone. And you can see that the lower border of the zygoma, which is zygomatic process of temporal bone, the lower border of the zygomatic process of temporal bone shows posteriorly a bony prominence which is called articular tubercle. That articular tubercle is very important for stability of temporomandibular joint, as it prevents anterior displacement of the temporomandibular joint. There is a foramen here near the occipito-mastoid suture, which is mastoid foramen for emissary veins. There is a foramen on the zygomatic bone anteriorly called zygomatico-facial foramen. And here there is a foramen on the back of the frontal process of zygomatic bone, which is called zygomatico-temporal foramen. And these are the most of the features of the normal lateralis. However, we have certain features that are not related to normal lateralis. They are a specific region and that are located in the gap, the features that are located in the gap deep to the zygomatic arch. You know, the space deep to the zygomatic arch connect the temporal fossa here with the infratemporal fossa deep to the ramus of the mandible. And we will give you, I will show you a figure closer to this region, that is the region deep to the zygomatic arch. This is a closer figure. This is the zygomatic arch. This is the greater wing of the sphenoid, squamous temporal bone. This is the pterion. And you can see this is the greater wing of the sphenoid. Here, in this close view, there is a crest on the lower border of the greater wing of the sphenoid, which is called infratemporal crest of a greater wing of a sphenoid. Infratemporal crest of a greater wing of a sphenoid. We will take a closer view to this region. Of course, a closer view to this region must remove the zygomatic arch. So next figure, you will see that the zygomatic arch is removed. This is the sterion, of course. Here is the feature of the space deep to the zygomatic arch. The zygomatic arch here is removed. So this is the greater wing of a sphenoid, and this is the infratemporal crest of a greater wing of a sphenoid. This infratemporal crest of a greater wing of a sphenoid separates the part of a greater wing of a sphenoid that forms the temporal fossae from the part of a greater wing of a sphenoid that will be studied in the norma basalis, forming the roof of the infratemporal fossae. So this crest, the infratemporal crest, is a boundary of temporal and infratemporal surfaces of a greater wing of a sphenoid. Also, when you remove the zygomatic arch, you can see the back of maxilla. Of course, this is the alveolar process of maxilla carrying the teeth, and this is deep to zygomatic arch, the back of maxilla, the posterior aspect of maxilla. You can see that behind maxilla is a fissure, which is called pterygomaxillary fissure. It is called pterygomaxillary fissure because this piece of bone, which is also part of a sphenoid bone, is called pterygoid process. So this fissure is between the pterygoid process and maxilla, so it is pterygomaxillary fissure. Later on, we will pass into details of the space deep to this pterygomaxillary fissure that is called pterygopalatine fossae that will be studied later on. So now we will discuss features of the back looking to the skull, which is norma occipitalis. Norma occipitalis is formed by the right and left parietal bones, by the squamous occiput bone, and by the mastoid temporal bones. Features seen in the norma occipitalis is the lambda, which is the point of meeting of lambdoid suture, of the sagittal suture with the lambdoid suture. This is the lambda. And here you can see a point of meeting between the lambdoid suture, parietomastoid suture, and occipitomastoid suture. This point is called asterion, and it is also a membranous structure and neonate that's called posterolateral fontanelle that ossify at about 3 to 6 months of age. The midline of the lower part of norma occipitalis shows a bony prominence that called external occipital protuberance. The tip of this bony prominence is called inion. And from this external occipital protuberance, you have two bilateral ridges that are called superior nuchaline, bony ridges radiating laterally from the external occipital protuberance, superior nuchaline. It is called superior nuchal line because it is the upper line of the neck, superior nuchal line. Below it is a neck, above it is a head. And above this superior nuchal line is also a bony ridge radiating laterally from the external occipital protuberance, although it is a fainter ridge compared to the prominence of the superior nuchal line. This ridge above the superior nuchal line is called the highest nuchal line. This is superior nuchal line. This is highest nuchal line. Here we can see also the mastoid foramina for emissary vein near the occipitomastoid suture. We can see the mastoid notch for the gastric muscles and so on. These are the features of the norma occipitalis, the back view to the skull. This is the asterion. And now we have to describe the inferior view to the skull, which is called norma basalis. This norma must be divided into three regions by two imaginary horizontal lines. The first imaginary horizontal line passes in between the two points behind the last molar tooth, and the other, or the second imaginary horizontal line, is at the interior border of this foramen, which is called foramen magnum. So by these two imaginary lines, the base of the skull, which is called norma basalis, or the inferior aspect of the skull, is divided into anterior region, middle region, and posterior region. And we will describe first the anterior region, then the middle region, then the posterior region. The anterior region is called the heart palate. This is a closer view to the heart palate. It is bounded anteriorly and laterally by the alveolar process of maxilla carrying the teeth. The heart palate is formed by the right and left palatine processes of maxilla anteriorly in the anterior two-thirds of it. The heart palate in the anterior two-thirds is formed by the right and left palatine processes of maxilla, while posteriorly in the posterior one-third it's formed by the horizontal plates of palatine bone. Therefore, this suture is an intermaxillary suture, and this is an interpalatine suture, and this is a palatomaxillary suture. The anterior end of the intermaxillary suture contains a fossae, which is called incisive fossae, that lie behind the incisor teeth, and this incisive fossae contains incisive foramina. Also, the lateral end of palatomaxillary suture, behind its lateral end is a big foramen called the greater palatine foramen. Behind this greater palatine foramen is a small foramina, which about 1 to 2, maybe 3, that are called lesser palatine foramina. This is the greater palatine foramina behind the lateral end of the palatomaxillary suture, greater palatine foramina. Behind the greater palatine foramina are 2 to 3 lesser palatine foramina. The piece of bone containing the lesser palatine foramina is called pyramidal process of palatine bone. The bone behind the last molar tooth, this piece, is called tuberosity of maxilla. You can see that the posterior border of heart palate projecting in the midline to form the posterior nasal spine. This is all about the heart palate, the most anterior region of norma basalis, or base of the skull, which is the inferior view of the skull. Now we will pass to the middle region. In order to describe the middle region, we will divide it into two fields. The median field, which is this quadrilateral field, the medial field, and two lateral fields. Starting with the description of the median field. The median field shows anteriorly the posterior nasal aperture that divides by the vomer bone, which is bone of the nasal septum, into right and left posterior nasal aperture. You can see that the posterior nasal aperture is bounded anteriorly by the heart palate and bounded posteriorly by the body of the sphenoid, and on the sides it is bounded by the pterygoid process that we had just described in the pterygomaxillary fissure. You can see that this pterygoid process of sphenoid bone is divided into lateral pterygoid plate and medial pterygoid plate. So, union of the medial pterygoid plate and lateral pterygoid plate is called pterygoid process. And we had shown you that from the lateral aspect, the pterygoid process is related to the pterygomaxillary fissure from lateral side. But from medial side, from the posterior nasal aperture, the pterygoid process is in contact with the vertical plate of palatine bone. This is the horizontal plate of palatine bone forming the back of heart palate, and this horizontal plate is L-shaped because it continues there in the posterior nasal aperture with vertical plate of palatine bone that articulates with the pterygoid process here. You can see that the vomer part of nasal septum in the posterior nasal aperture divides above into two ala, and the ala articulates with the body of sphenoid and also articulates with the pterygoid process. And here, the size of the ala shows the vomerovaginal canal, and lateral to it, this is the palatovaginal canal. Also, you can see that the medial pterygoid plate, contains above a fossa, which is called the scaphoid fossa. But below, it contains a process that is called hamulus of medial pterygoid plate. This is the median band anteriorly. Posteriorly, the median band is formed by body of sphenoid that fuses with the basal part of occiput. Here we can see a tubercle which is called pharyngeal tubercle because it is related to the pharynx. This is all about the description of the median field of the middle region of norma basalis. This is the median field of the middle region of the norma basalis. Now I will talk about the lateral region here and there. Of course, you can see this lateral region is so complicated. Therefore, I will simplify it by dividing it into a diamond, a circle, and a triangle. The diamond is the greater wing of a sphenoid, which is the infratemporal surface of a greater wing of a sphenoid. You can see this is the temporal surface of a greater wing of a sphenoid, and this is the infratemporal surface of a greater wing of a sphenoid. Therefore, the anterolateral boundary of the diamond is the infratemporal crest of a greater wing of sphenoid, between temporal and infratemporal surface of a greater wing of sphenoid. While the posterolateral boundary of the diamond, greater wing of sphenoid, is a suture with the squamous temporal bone. You can see this suture. The anteromedial boundary of the diamond is a junction or a suture with the pterygoid process that divides into medial and lateral pterygoid plate. While the posteromedial boundary of the diamond is the junction with the triangle. The triangle is a petrous temporal bone, part of petrous temporal bone, which is one part of temporal bone. So the posteromedial border of the diamond is the junction with the triangular petrous temporal bone. You can see that this posteromedial border shows two foramina, an anterior big foramen ovale, and behind it is a small foramen spinosum. And this angle between the posterolateral border of the diamond and posteromedial border, this angle is related to spine of sphenoid. This is foramen spinosum, and this is the spine of sphenoid covering. This is the spine of sphenoid covering the foramen spinosum. So the posteromedial border of the diamond, infratemporal surface of the greater wing of sphenoid, along it is the foramen ovale anteriorly, and behind it and laterally foramen spinosum. The apex of the diamond posteriorly is related to the spine of sphenoid. Now I will talk about the circle. The circle is mandibular fossa that contains the condylar process of the mandible, in which it forms the temporomandibular joint. It is formed by the tympanic plate of temporal bone posteriorly and squamous temporal bone anteriorly. This is the tubercle, articular tubercle at the base of the zygomatic process of temporal bone, the zygoma. So this is mandibular fossa for the temporomandibular joint. Here you can see that the suture between the squamous temporal and tympanic plate, the tympano, the squamotympanic suture between squamous temporal and tympanic temporal, squamotympanic suture, contain a small piece of bone here that's called tegmen tympani. That is not so easily seen. Here is a small piece of bone called tegmen tympani in this suture. What's remaining is the triangular region, and we said that the triangular region is the petrous temporal bone, one part of temporal bone. The apex of the triangle shows an irregular fossa, which is called foramen lacerum. This foramen is closed and living by cartilage that is perforated by some non-significant vessels. The triangle forms a suture with the diamond, the greater wing of sphenoid, and this suture here contains a groove for cartilaginous part of the auditory tube. The suture between the triangular petrous temporal and the diamond greater wing of sphenoid contains a groove for the cartilaginous part of auditory tube. The base of the triangular petrous temporal bone shows the carotid canal, which is for passage of the internal carotid artery. This is all about the middle region, and we will pass to the posterior region. The posterior region shows in the midline the foramen magnum. Foramen magnum is bounded anteriorly by the basal occiput, posteriorly by the squamous occiput, and on the sides anteriorly by the condyles of occiput. The condyles of occipits shows a canal inside them, but it is not shown in this field. It is called hypoglossal canal, that is for passage of the 12 cranial nerve, hypoglossal nerve. Sometimes it is called anterior condylar canal because behind the condyles, this is a posterior condylar canal. This is the carotid canal, which is the base of the triangle, petrous temporal. And behind the carotid canal, this is the jugular foramen for the internal jugular vein. The carotid canal for the internal jugular, for the internal carotid artery. Behind it is the jugular foramen for the internal jugular vein. This jugular foramen is at the suture between petrous temporal bone and squamous temporal bone. It is covered by the jugular process. Also, lateral to the jugular foramen, you can see the styloid process of temporal bone. And between the styloid process and mastoid process, this is the mastoid process, is a foramen which is called the stylomastoid foramen, which is for passage of the facial nerve, the seventh cranial nerve. Between the external occipital protuberance, this is the external occipital protuberance, and this is the superior nuchal line. Which is above it is the norma occipitalis. So below the superior nuchal line is the norma basalis. Between the external occipital protuberance and the middle of posterior border of foramen magnum is a crest, which is called external occipital crest. At the middle of this external occipital crest are two bilateral ridges that are called inferior nuchal line. So we have superior nuchal line and inferior nuchal line, and in norma basalis we had also see so the highest nuchal line. So this is external occipital protuberance. From it to the foramen magnum is the external occipital crest. The middle of the external occipital crest shows bilateral inferior nuchal lines. This is all about norma basalis, which is the base of the skull, which is the inferior aspect of the skull. By that, we had finished the anatomy of the norma of the views of the skull from the front, norma frontalis, laterally, norma lateralis, above norma verticalis, and posteriorly norma occipitalis, and inferiorly the norma basalis, which is the base of the skull. And this is must be the end of the anatomy of the skull, osteology of the skull, part 1. So I will present you anatomy of the skull, part 2, that is concerned with cranial cavity, the cranial fossa, and also some regions that are of peculiar importance. For example, the nasal cavity, osteology of the nasal cavity, osteology of the mandible, osteology of the X-ray, radio anatomy of the skull. All of these are will be considered with the presentation of the skull part 2. Thank you very much.